Sir, can you start the session, sir?
Okay, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Can you start, ma'am?
Okay, sir. Good afternoon, ah.
Pratap Reddy garu.
Sir.
Oh, and few participants have joined. Can we wait for another 5 more minutes?
Yeah, no problem, sir. Sure, sir.
If you don't mind.
No problem, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Shall I wait for 5 minutes?
Yeah, you can wait, madam, just for 5 minutes.
Okay, sir.
And the participants only 30 are there. So let us see for another 5 minutes. Pratap sir, I think it's 2:10. Shall we start, sir?
Madam, can you start, madam, session?
Okay, sir.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, very good afternoon to all. And this is Dr. Jada Nagalakshmi, working as Associate Professor in Vigyan Pharmacy College, Vadlamudi. Before going to the session, I want to say my thanks to AP Skill Development Programs, as well as Vigyan Pharmacy College Management and Principal, Sir Srinivas Babu Garu, to be giving me this opportunity to share my knowledge with all the students who are there in the presentation. Before going to that, I think all of, from the background of, I think it may be the pharmacy or science or M-Pharm. All of you may attend in the yesterday session. You may have now got the knowledge regarding the what is pharmacology, what is the need of pharmacology in drug discovery and development. I think so. Before going to that, first of all, why we need to study the pharmacology in drug discovery and what is the role of pharmacology in the drug discovery and development. That is it is a major part when we can see the effect of drug on individual. Wait a minute. Sorry for inconvenience. I think everybody may know the various branches which are there in our pharmacy. In that, the most important one, the first one is the pharmaceutics. In that, we will study about the regarding the formulations which are available in the market and what are the techniques to prepare the various formulations. After that, we need to know the analyze the quantity by using the various analytical techniques in analysis, pharmaceutical analysis. And finally, while coming to the administration of drug into the human being, the major role of pharmacology plays here by observing the efficacy and the safety of the drug in people as well as the human voluntaries. That is why we also call it as pharmacology is the heart of entire pharmacy. Without heart, we doesn't live, we are unable to survive. Similarly, without pharmacology, we are unable to survive in the pharmacy profession. With this brief introduction, I am starting the complete details about the experimental pharmacology. What is the difference between the pharmacology and experimental pharmacology? Why we differentiate into two types is, where in case of pharmacology, we are studying detailed knowledge about the drug related pharmacokinetics and pharmacokinetics there in the human being. Where in case of experimental pharmacology, the same drug is applied to the or administered to the animal, and we need to find out the pharmacokinetic and the pharmacodynamic profile prior to the human being administration to know the safety as well as efficacy of the drug and to minimize the complications related to the drug while we administer directly to the human being. Within the experimental pharmacology, majorly animals are used almost every laboratory wherever the biological studies are needed. Not only pharmacology, it is also useful for the screening of vaccines, seras, preparations, whichever administered to the human being. In pharmacological research, the animals are being used to test to know the effect of drug before administered to the human being. That is nothing than clinical trials. Not only clinical trials, it is also useful for animals to testing the safety and efficacy and to trying the students in educational institutions. Now, what is the importance of animals in biomedical research? Why we are using animals instead of human beings direct? Why can't we choose the human beings directly? Why we are preferring the animals instead of the human being? That is a major question we need to know before using the or before selecting the animals for experiment. The first thing here is the animal and the human beings having the similarities related to organs, body, and the system. which are having the similarities to that of animals. That's why we are preferring the animals for testing the drug response. But even though having the similarities, why we are choosing only animal and compared to the human being is the animal having the less lifespan when compared to the human being. If the drug is directly administered to the human being during that period and post administration, if or she may affected by the unexpected events, she need to survive with that event and the complication, it may lead to the disability throughout the lifespan. But it is not like that animal, because animal having the short lifespan, they can survive only up to either 3 years, 4 years, maximum 10 years, depend on the lifespan. That's why we are selecting the animal as a major to screen the drug effect prior to the human being. That is the first reason why we are preferring the animal. And another one is the susceptibility of getting the infections same to that of animal to human being. Like if you observe the fungal infections and bacterial infections and cardiovascular related complications, that will be same. We can see the same complications in animal as well as the human being. That is another reason why we are choosing the animals to test the effect of drug on animals before administered to the human being. And next one, while conducting the trials, in case of human being, we need to pay the money to human being, because without collecting the money, none of the voluntary are not willing to participate in the study. That needs the lot of money to complete the single trial in the CRO, contract research organization. But where in case of animal, they doesn't require money. They doesn't ask anything from us. They will be participate easily, and we can accommodate the animals easily and monitor the animals throughout the experiment period very easily when compared to the human being. That is the reason why we are choosing the animals for experiments. I think, are you following or not, all of you? Just raise your hand if you have any doubts. Meanwhile, that is the reason why we are choosing the animals instead of the clean human being. Next, we come into the common laboratory animals which are using in the preclinically. They are differentiated into the three: rodents, non-rodents, and the miscellaneous. Rodents. First one is a rodent, because of that property, they are always digging the soil. That's why we consider as an rodents. And choosing the rodents firstly for the number of activities, including mouse, rat, guinea pig, and hamsters. Another one, next category of animals and commonly using for the various activities is non-rodents, like rabbits, dog, cat, and monkey. And miscellaneous category and amphibians are also used for the number of activities, including frog, pigeon, zebra fish, and chicken. These are all the small laboratory animals, where in case of large laboratory animals like monkeys, dogs are also used for the number of trials. That may be preferably taking for the particular trials, not including the all type of preclinical trials. Now coming to the percentage of applicants of animals in individual trials and overall ratio, what type of animals are highly preferable in the currently in preclinical research or experimental pharmacology. Here you can observe the percentage ratio including individual animals, where in case of reptiles and amphibians, about 100%, we are using only 0.5% for screening the drug activity, reptiles and amphibians. That means they are in the large area, surface area, and we need to maintain the large experimental room to accommodate the animal and to prolong the total duration of the study also. We should maintain the same environment. That's why the priority is very, very less while in case of the amphibian and reptiles. And next one, least priority is mammals, it including monkeys and other chimpanzees. This here also we are choosing very least priority. The same problem is arising with the mammals also. Next, coming to the birds, is it birds are useful for doing the preclinical trials? Obviously yes, because some of the drugs may produce in a similar effect in the birds that we can't observe in the remaining animal. For this, the best example is Distalis. Distalis is a cardiotonic drug. It can induce the vomiting, that is the endpoint method, endpoint response, end response in Distalis bioassay that we can perform with the PGNs only. This is the simplest method we are choosing for the bioassay of Distalis. That's why birds are also one of the part to do the preclinical trials. Not only this Distalis, these birds are the major tool to screen the toxicity in air also. That is to predict the air pollution in environment. How these birds are helpful to predict the air pollution in environment is birds only can survive and can fly up to the maximum height. If air contains the maximum number of pollutants that will be available in the highest height, the birds can contaminate by the toxins. By collecting the bird's fecal material, we can estimate whether the air is polluted or free. By observing the fecal material of birds, we can predict the air pollution also. It is also one of the important diagnostic tool to test the air safety and air pollution. Next priority is the rats, rodents. These are frequently used animals for doing the number of activities for various preclinical researches. And now another one is that 12% given to the fishes. Why we are given 12% to the fishes is, especially for aquatic animals, fishes are highly preferable to screen the neurological activities, drugs which affecting or influencing the neurons and their function. Zebra fishes are highly preferable, and the number of preclinical models are available with by using the zebra fishes. That's why the fish occupy the 12% rather than the rats. Because nowadays, if you see the people, neurological disorders are day by day increasing due to the lifestyle and environmental changes. And the highest priority which is given to the always mice, that occupies the 74% in the regular trials. Why we giving the 74% to the mice when compared to the remaining all animals? If you observe the size of the mice and the breeding as well as the birth capacity, it will be very high when compared to the remaining all animals. Any mice can give the maximum of 20 to 25 liters at a single birth. That's why we can produce the number of population within less span of time. That is the first criteria. And the second one is the mice having the least lifespan. They can survive up to 2 years only. That's why these are the widely acceptable small animal to conducting the number of trials. That is the percentage criteria which is given for the individual animals according to the need. Now coming to the individual animals and how they are using and what type of activities we can perform with these animals. First one is the rat. We all are very well known about the rats, and whatever rats we are seeing in our house, that is not used for the screening and testing. But where in case of albino rats, these are inbreed animals. These only suitable for treating the testing the drugs in effect. Albino rats are highly preferable. And again, albino rats are two types are there, Wister rats and Sprague Dowley rats. What is the difference when compared to the Wister and Sprague Dowley? We can observe by and comparing by the head and the tail. If you see the Wister rat, the head is wide and the tail is short rather than the body length. Where in case of the scragged owly rat, the head is longer and tail also very length when compared to the body. While selecting the rats for study, we should confirming which one is suitable for our study, whether Worcester rats and scragged owly rats. How can we came to know whether Worcester rat is suitable for our study or scragged owly rat is suitable for our study is by observing the physiological property as well as psychological behavior of the two animals. Both are rats only, but individually, if you see, Worcester rats are highly aggressive when compared to the ST rats. That's why Worcester rats are highly preferable for screening the drugs for hypertension. Where in case of scragged owly rats are suitable for screening drugs acting on the reproductive system. That is the species different. And if you observe the weight of the rat is of minimum of 350 grams maximum and minimum of 150 grams. Those only selected for the study. That is regarding rat. The next animal is guinea pig. When compared to the rat, the guinea pig is highly docile and sensitive. That means it is very sensitive to do the handling because the skin of guinea pig is very sensitive and highly opposes the entry of any dust particles. Like other rodents, it can be easily handled. And it is different from the rodents by mild changes, like it is highly docile and the chances of getting TB is very high. And it can also affect easily by anaphylactic shock if drug having the chances of inducing allergy. That's why these guinea pigs are highly preferable for doing the activities with drugs which affecting the either histamine levels or altering the histamine function in the body, because histamine is the major substances which induces the allergic reactions in the body. And it is a key role of anaphylactic shock also. That's why these guinea pigs are highly preferable for screening antihistaminic activity in the animal. Next, if these guinea pigs are not able to synthesize daily requirement of vitamin C, these are deficiency of vitamin C. And next animal is the mouse. As I discussed previously, when compared to the all animals, these mouses are regularly and occupies the 70% in screening. Why? Because these are the smallest laboratory animals and we can easily keep and handle and require the very less space for housing and uniformly breeded. As I said earlier, it gives a large number at a time, 20 to 25 litters can produce from the single mice. That's why the population can increase very rapidly. And Swiss albino mice is the most widely used strain for laboratory investigations. And another property of the mice is it is highly sensitive to the least dose of the drug also. That is regarding the laboratory animal mouse. Now coming to the hamster. This is the third laboratory animal which is commonly used for screening the various activities like drugs which are affecting the GIT function. If you observe the hamster, we are available with two species. First one is a Syrian hamster and second one is golden hamster. And both are physiologically and psychologically same. Only problem with this is requirement of the food. Food intake is somewhat different, except that remaining two remaining properties are similar in the both Syrian as well as golden hamsters. And this, if you see the hamster, it looks like a chunky body with short legs and similar like that of guinea pigs only, but not a complete guinea pig. And they have prominent cheek pouches. That's why after intake of the food. This hamster hold the food in the cheeks and slowly eating that food. That's why we need to regulate the providing the food to hamster. That is very important reason. Along with it having the diminutive fluffy tail and round ears. This is also widely used for testing the drugs acting on GIT as well as uterus. The next animal which is familiar to all is a rabbit. Now, if you see the rabbit, we can easily know that it is highly sensitive by seeing it the skin itself. If you observe the rabbit skin, that is completely in red. And if you observe the eyes of the rabbit, that will be complete cherryish color, red in color. And we can see clearly observe the pupil size. That's why rabbits are highly preferable for the drugs acting on eye, as well as drugs which are used for treatment of skin and skin related complications. Because the surface area of the rabbit skin is very high and we can easily apply the drug to skin of the rabbit without any complications. Because in case of rat and mite, we need to hold the animal in restraint while applying the any drug to the skin of the rat or mice. But that is not applicable for the rabbit because we can hold the rabbit with our hand very easily and frequently. Next. We are having the regularly, we are using the New Zealand species. New Zealand white rabbits are widely used for preclinical activities and using of this large volume parenterals and screening of bioassay of insulin. That is also most important application of the rabbit. That is nothing but test for pyrogens. While we administered the large volume parenterals to people, not only large volume parenterals, any parenteral preparation before release into the market, it should pass the test for sterility. The test for sterility can be performed by using first one is the rabbit and second one is the microorganisms by microorganism cultures. In case of rabbit, why we are preparing rabbit, even though we are having the number of animals, is rabbits are highly sensitive to mild variation in the pyrogens in the blood. If mild variation in the pyrogens in the formulations and presence of any pyrogens in the formulation may lead to the elevation of the body temperature of rabbit, that will be useful to evaluate the parenterals, it including injections, intravenous preparations and a large volume parenterals as well as small volume parenterals. Along with it also be useful for the bioassay of insulin. It is a major tool, bioassay of insulin, by administering the insulin to the rabbit, and we can estimating the blood glucose levels in rabbit by collecting regularly blood from rabbit ears. That is the important applications of rabbit along with the eye as well as the skin preparations. And other one, this can also use it for the curare mimetic drugs, tubocurarin. That is in curare alkaloids. The use of the curare alkaloid is to act as a pre-anesthetic medication to relax the skeletal muscles and total muscles. And while testing the curare alkaloids, we need to test it on the rabbit. It should paralyze the neck muscle of the rabbit. That is another application of the rabbit. Now coming to the cat. We all are very well known about the cat, and what is the special property of the cat when compared to the remaining animals? It can smell very fastly and easily because of the nociception receptors are highly active in the cat. That is the one property of the cat. Along with it, this can be used for the cardiovascular behavior and biomedical research, like drugs acting on the CVS, as well as other biomedical research, including vaccines and syrup preparations. Because cat having that distinct nictitating membrane, so it can smell the any type of substance easily. Using this, based on this property only, this can be used for the screening of drugs acting on the CNS also. And the cats are also the useful for model to studying the transmission of vitamins and minerals from fetus to the newborn baby. How the intake of how the food containing the nutrients and vitamins transferred to the baby from placenta. Those type of studies also can be done by using the cat as an animal. And not only this, it can also be used for the neuropharmacology. As I said previously, because of that, it having the consciousness, highly active at any time, and elect based on that property only, we are choosing for screening the neuropharmacological activity, toxicology, oncology, and chromosomal abnormality. Why we need to testing for the chromosomal abnormality is to testing the genetical disorders. If there any chromosomal abnormality is find out after, during and post administration of the drug, that may lead to the genetical disorder. To avoid that, we need to confirm whether our drug doesn't inducing any chromosomal abnormality. This is the advantage with cat especially. Now coming to the next animal, this is the large animals. Until whatever we discuss, except cat, remaining all are the small animals only. While coming to the cat and dog, all these are considered as in large animals because they need the large surface area for accommodation as well as maintenance of that animal also very highly cost. Huge requirement is needed for maintenance and survival of these animals. While in case of the dogs, we are preferably using mongrel and beagle dogs. Now, what type of activities we can do with this dog? The most preferable large experimental animal dog, and it can be useful for the cardiovascular related complications like screening of antihypertensives and screening of antiarrhythmics and screening of drugs acting on congestive heart failure. All these complications, we need to choose the dog is a preclinical model. Along with the major advantage of dog also, it having the similar as well as small elementary kennel, and easily we can observe the pharmacokinetic of the drug and how it is moved and what is the time taken for elimination also. That is regarding the dogs. The next animal is monkey. We all are very well known about the monkeys, and these are simply amphibians. And what type of activities we can do by using with monkeys is majorly reproductive studies. Drugs which are affecting the reproductive system as well as GIT and CNS and CVS. And these monkeys are also favorable for the pharmacokinetic studies to know the plasma half-life, elimination and volume of distribution and T half of the individual drug. The monkeys are highly favorable. Along with these are also preferable for the screening of drug for psychopharmacological activities. Psychopharmacological studies like psychosis. Why we are specifically telling that psychopharmacological studies means because we all are arrived from the monkeys only. That's why the nervous system and the behavior of the monkeys similar to that of our human beings only. That's why the drugs which are acting on the psychopharmacology and treatment for schizophrenia and depression and other various psychological disorders. The monkeys are preferable animals and first animal to testing. And the other one is frog, which is the last animal. And why we are using the frog? And previously these frogs are used for the demonstration purpose in the students for undergraduations in pharmacy, but now the our PCI restricted to usage of frogs due to scarcity, but still we can do the minor activities by using the heart preparation, isolated heart of the frog, to estimate the effect of drugs on frog heart, as well as skeletal muscle preparation, frog rectus abdominis muscle preparation, to know the effect of drug on the muscle. And it is a common laboratory animal, amphibian. It can survive both in land and water. And because of the skin, this having the specific property to take the respiration through skin also. And anatomically, it the heart of the frog contains 3 chambers only, which is a major property differ from the other mammals. This is regarding the common laboratory animals, including both small and laboratory animals, and how they are producing the response. Now, coming to the 3-year concept. What is 3 years? Why we need to know before administering the drugs and before using the animal for the study? The 3 years, first R is refinement, second R is reduction, and third R is a replacement. Why we should know about this one is because even though we are using the small animal and the small number only, but we should follow some ethical guidelines and principle while using the animals for the trials. That is this 3R principle. Principle of good science designed by the scientist to improve the animal welfare and scientific accuracy. And this 3R concept is implemented by the CPCSCA, Committee for the Purpose of Control and Supervision of Experiments on Animals. Maximum, they need to monitor and regulate the activities on animal. Whenever you require the animals for doing the studies, then we can proceed. Otherwise, we should not do any harm to the animal. That is a major concept. It including first R, refinement. Refinement, whatever we can available, we need to refine the drugs and we should reduce the drug administration to animal, finding the alternative way instead of the animal to improve the survivability of the animal, finding the ways, making the animal which can live the better than the labs. Next one, reduction. By reducing the intake of laboratory animals, if the experiment is required the 60 number of animals, as well as you can get the results by using the 20 number animals also. At that time, we should follow the less number by reducing the regular intake of the animal, whatever we are getting the same result. That is the reduction. Using the few animals as possible as get the good result. But we should not avoid the minimum requirement for the laboratory animals that we should follow. Because by using the single animal and 2 animals, we should not confirming my drug producing this type of effect and our drug having so and so activity. That is not actable. Because we should follow the minimum number wherever we require, wherever we need, we can reduce the count of the animal. And it is highly applicable for the drugs for testing the acute carcinogenicity and genotoxicity. At the time, usually we need the large number of animals to know the accurate results. But we can get the same result by reducing the number of animals also. That is regarding reduction. Next one, replacement. What is this replacement? By replacing the animal, using the non-animal alternative models wherever applicable. That is, instead of animal, we can use the tissue culture and alternative animal models. That we can, if you get the same result by doing that experiment with externally without any animal, then we can replace the animal with animal activity with the tissue experiments. That is the third R. These are the 3 R's. Refinement, reduction, and replacement. We should know our 3 R's before doing the activities and before design the protocol for doing preclinical trials. Now, this is one of the best examples for alternative models. Why we are choosing the alternative and replacement? Because to reduce the unnecessary injury an unnecessary harm to the animal. Animal, as much as possible, we should reduce the regular usage of animal. The best example is fish instead of the sheep. Instead of sheep, we can use the fish for doing activities, as well as flies we can use for various activities by replacing the animal. That is the alternative models to reduce the usage of regular animals. Now coming to the most important thing, legal and ethical responsibility. While people, whoever using the animals for their activity, before using that, we should know the what are the ethical principle and legal approaches we should complete it. That is, by getting the approval only, we should take the animal for our study. Without approval and without permission, we should not do any activities in the animal, because some of the people may having the rabbits in their household. At any cost, we should not encourage any people to administer the drug to arbitrary animals like rabbits in our house to testing. That is highly offensive. Now, before handling the animal, while handling the animal, we should take care, because we should not create any fear. That is the first ethical principle. We should not create pain to the animal. The animal should not suffer with unnecessary pain. Like rabbit is the best example. If you see the rabbits, while holding the rabbit, what the everybody will do and practicing is by holding with the ears. But that is not an actual process for holding the rabbit, because ears are having the thermoregulatory centers. Whenever if you hold the rabbit by ear, the thermoregulatory centers will be altered and stimulated, may lead to the elevated body temperature in the rabbit. That's why while holding the rabbit, we should keep our hand below the legs and another hand on the back of the abdomen, so that the animal is unable to escape from our hand and free from the stress. That is the first thing we should remember while doing the activities on animals. And next one is, we should provide the good care towards the health and the well-being of the animal. What it means? What is the good care of health and care of the animal is? It including every aspect of the animal living. It may be the food intake and providing of the food and placing the animals in cage. For example, if you don't have in the sufficient number of the cages, if you keep the all animals at a time, like more than 10 mice in the single cage, that is not good for the animal health. That we should not promote it. As well as, we need to monitor the animals regularly for the seasonal infection to prevent the contamination of one animal to another animal and to maximum avoid the disturbances from the animals. Similarly, we need to avoid the contact of rodents to non-rodents also. These are the important ethical principles we should remember while doing the activities. And it is important that animal and our handling persons, before handling the animal, we should restrain them properly. Later only, we should administer the drug. Without proper restraining, we should not forcefully administer the drug to the animal. That may lead to the unnecessary stress to the animal. We should not encourage those type of practice in our regular days. Now, coming to the experimental animals, what are the things we should remember while doing all activities on animals? The animals should be suitably from the breeding. Like initially I said that rats, like albino rats, if people are interested to do the activities with the rats, if they bought a rat from any area or household rat, those are not suitable for the doing activities, because the only inbreed rats as well as the people whoever purchasing the rats, they need to purchase it from the licensing authority. The seller should have the license. From there only we should purchase the laboratory animals, because they are maintaining the environment, which is essential for the survival of the animal throughout the lifespan. That is the first thing we need to remember while purchasing the laboratory animals, suitably breeded. It should not be cross-breeded. And second thing is gently handled. While handling the animals, we should take care about the animal health as well as our also. We should not forcefully handle the animal. It should prevent the stress to the animal. And last one is the properly use. Without use and without necessity, we should not use the animals. Because if the necessity is there, you want to test it the effect of drug on animal, then you can choose. Without any necessity, we should not use the unnecessarily animal for the activities. These three things we need to remember and keep it in mind while doing and before starting the experiments on animals. Next, the selection of experimental animals is entirely depends on the three major criteria. What are the three is? First one is nature of the experiment. And second one is type of drug activity to be evaluated. And third one is the specific character of the experimental animal. Now, first one is nature of the experiment. If you observe the experiment nature, like whatever I discussed in previously, dogs. If you see the dogs, those are highly preferable for the drugs acting on the cardiovascular system, as well as drugs which affect in the blood vessel function. That is the first criteria we should remember while selecting the animal. Based on the nature of experiment, we need to choose. Similarly, where in case of the drugs affecting the reproductive system, at that time, we need to select the either monkeys or guinea pigs, because the reproductive system of monkey as well as guinea pig similar to that of the human beings, and the menstrual cycle also similar to that of the human being. That's why the nature of the experiment will decide the entire selection of the animal. That is the first criteria. And similarly, Sprague-Dawley rats. As I said previously, Sprague-Dawley rats are very quiet and calm. They doesn't get any angry. That's why they should not be suitable for the testing anxiety activity, anti-anxiety activity. That is also one of the best example for the nature of experiment, how that influences the selection of experimental animal. Next one, type of drug activity to be evaluated. How that drug activity can be evaluated by using the laboratory animal. Here, initially, I gave the one example, that is PGNs. PGNs are the suitable to testing the drug response, especially distalis. The response which can seen in the distalis in PGN is vomiting. Vomiting is the final response of distalis in PGN. That is the another criteria. Based on that activity only, we are selecting the distalis, PGNs for the distalis assay. Why the remaining animals we not suitable for this distalis? Because remaining rat and mice, they don't have in the vomiting centers. They doesn't vomit the food, because distalis can stimulate the CTZ and vomiting centers in the brain. That is an key point we need to remember while estimating the potency and the efficacy of distalis. Based on that only, we are choosing the PGNs, and PGNs are highly sensitive and they can get easily vomiting due to any drug, especially distalis. That is the drug activity to be evaluated. And similarly, hypoglycemic effect of the insulin. That can be performed by using the rabbits only. Because the rabbit blood glucose levels, we can estimate easily, and we can collect the blood at intervals easily from rabbit only. But where in case of the rat and mice, it is unable. But mice also preferable, rat it is unable. That's why the drug activity also plays a major role for selection of the laboratory animal. And next one is the specific character of the experimental animal. How the specific character may influence in the experiment and how it is useful for us is, if you see the some of the animals, especially rabbit for eyes, drugs acting on eye, we can easily detect the effect of drugs on eye in rabbit with our eyes itself. By clearly we can observe the change in the pupillary size and diameter. These are the three criteria which influencing the selection of experimental animals for doing the studies in preclinically. Next one is the in vivo. What is in vivo and what is ex vivo? While doing the activities, if you using the total animal for our study, then we consider as an in vivo studies. But if it is used only isolated organ for any studies, then we consider as an ex vivo studies. For example, isolated frog heart preparations for testing the effect of drugs on heart, and isolated uterine preparations for testing the contraction of uterus in the presence of various drugs, and isolated skeletal muscle and trachea to testing the bronchospasm and bronchospasm and bronchodilation effect, as well as the skeletal muscle. All these are considered as an ex vivo experiments, and mild difference is there. And if you observe the preclinical trials, mainly we are considering about the in vivo trials only. Ex vivo is for only students demonstration purpose and to get the knowledge on the drug and their response, like frog rectus abdominis muscle preparation for acetylcholine response, contraction response. And next criteria is selection of species depends on the many factors, how they influencing and what are the factors. Let's we see. First one is the technical issues. What are the technical issues and how they influencing the selection of laboratory animals? The major technical issue is that we all are very well known about the area which is available for accommodation of the animals. If you observe the mice and the rats, we can accommodate within the small cage and by keep it in the small room. The number of animals can more when compared to the large animals in single room. But wherein apply in case of dogs, cats and monkeys, they need the largest area to survive. And it is not possible to keep like a rat and mice, like in the, keep it in the box. It is highly impossible because dog has to move regularly with the particular place. And we need to maintain the regular exercise habit to the dog, and a regular bathing for the dog is also influenced. That's why, because of the technical issues only, like species and number needed and the health of the animal, we are selecting the animal, whether it is large animal or small animal. The best example for this, antihypertensive activity. Usually the antihypertensive activity can be performing with the dog only. But in case of academics and educational institution, that is highly impossible, and we don't having any permission for the large animals. That's why we do with the experiment by using the rats instead of the dogs, because by using dog also we can do this, we can get the same results by using the NABP apparatus, non-invasive blood pressure instrument. Based on that we can estimate the antihypertensive effect of the drug. And next one, availability of animal husbandry, that is the availability of husk in the cages. In case of rat and mice, they can survive easily under rice floor, and rice husk is frequently using for housing of the rats and mice. But that is not possible and not feasible for the cats. That's why animal husbandry also plays a major factor which can influence in the selection of animals. Next, public concern regarding usage of certain species. it will create the more impact on entire our trial also, because if any person knowing so and so particular industry people or so and so first organization doing the activities by using either sheep or goat or any dog, they always used to suppressing and deviate our interest by arising the issues related the animal use. That is the most important criteria for selection of the laboratory animals. But that is not possible with mice and rat. They never give objection while using the rat and mice as well as rabbit. And the last and most important thing is the final consideration, because without financial support, we doesn't do any activities. It is highly impossible to do the all research related activities. That's why while purchasing the rat as well as the dog obviously very high in cost. Where in case of rat, it can be available at 250 rupees. Here in case of mice, it is around 150 rupees. That is another and most important factor for selection of the species for our activity. But even though we should justify why we are choosing this animal for this study, without proper justification, we should not select any species and any animal for our study. Next, coming to the individual animals and what type of activities we can do with this animals. Wait for a few minutes, I will be back. Okay, now coming to the next session, that is individual activities with the animals. First and most important, already I said in previously, 70% of activities are done with the help of mice only. That's why the mice are the most frequently used small laboratory animals. These are highly preferable in the cancer and the genetic research. Why? Because if you see the disease statistics, the death statistics, the cancer is the first and most important disorder which induces the death in worldwide also. Now it is replaced by another virus infection, but that is temporary. But always the cancer plays the first place in the death. That's why the always the researchers are find out the new drug which can save the life of the cancer patient or which may be extend the life of cancer people. That's why the anti-cancer activities are creating very demand in the preclinical pharmacology. While we are observing the anti-cancer drugs or anti-cancer activity, no doubt our drug may act the cellular level. At that time, the drug can induce in the genetic changes, can produce as the genetic alterations. That's why it is also one of the most important research, genetic engineering and genetic research. Is there any abnormality in the gene? These two create the very high impact in the preclinical pharmacology. If any one of you are interested to do the pharmacology, better to concentrate in these two areas. This will have in the very bright future, no doubt at all. And next one is acute toxicity studies. What is acute toxicity? And why we need to confirm do the acute toxicity studies before administer the drug in drug before release the drug into the market? The whatever the drug or chemical or food item, anything before release into the market, we should confirm it whether it is free from the acute toxicity or not. The all acute toxicity studies could be or should be done according to the OECD guidelines only. The entire world should follow the OECD guidelines to do the acute toxicity studies. What is this acute toxicity? I think you might know about the last year disaster which has happened in the Vizag because of the release of styrene gas. At that time, if you observe the cases of people who have died within seconds whenever they exposed to the house, exposure from the environment, they died due to severe inhalation of the styrene gas which is there in the environment. That is acute toxicity. Initial people, whoever exposed immediately, complete inhalation of the large amount of styrene gas. Later, what they do? People whoever awake from the at 6 o'clock and 7 o'clock, they also inhale that styrene gas. But we were observed only mild complication like itching, irritation, because already people whoever died, they take the more and large amount of the styrene which is there in the environment. That is acute toxicity. At a time, large amount of the drug, if you administer to the animal, what may be the toxicity? It is very important to know the, predict the toxicity of the any tablet or formulation. If the drug is safer in acute toxicity studies, no doubt at all, we can give safely to the individual at least doses. For this acute toxicity studies, we need to sacrifice the animal after completion of the period. That's why always we are preferring the mice for this study, because mice, already I said the initially, they can give the birth around 25 to 30 in single labor. That's why we can produce the large number in less period. That doesn't influencing the any economical matter also. That is another advantage why we are choosing the rats, mice for this acute toxicity studies. And next one, these mice are also useful for the screening of drugs, especially for CNS activity, including the memory. I think you might know about, when compared to the rat and mice, mice is highly sharp and it can bite within fraction of second if you are in a lenient position. Because of that alertness, that CNS nervous system is highly active. By taking this consideration and that mimic the activities similar to that of human being, whenever if you place it in any special chamber, like a isolated chamber or any mazes and environment or dark room, that will be mimic the activities of ours. That's why we are choosing the mice are the best for CNS activity, acute toxicity, and cancer and genetic research. Next, how we can administer the drug to mice? Various routes are available, but frequently we are choosing the intraperitoneal route of administration. How can we administer this intraperitoneum is by holding the animal with the ears, back of the ears, and placing the needle lower quadrant of the abdomen. It is very easiest one when compared to the remaining routes, and we can directly administer the drug into entire abdomen cavity. And we can administer the lipophilic drugs and both drugs to this route. Where in case of subcutaneous route of administration is administering the drug between the two ears by holding the skin which is there on the back of ears. This will be useful to administer the hormonal preparations to test the activity, especially insulin. And next one, we can also give the intraorally also. We can administer the drug directly to orally also, mouse also, by giving the intraoral needle. Oral feeding needles are available by administering the drug directly into the esophagus and the oral cavity. Now coming to the types of mouses in research pharmacology, we are preferably using the genetically modified mice for specific activities wherever we need the alteration of the gene, and we can minimize the usage of regular animal, because while we are administering the drug to the animal or for any activity, we need to induce the specific complication or toxicity, that is induction. But if you selecting this genetically modified mice, there is no need of induction of the disorder and disease to the particular mice. That is the only advantage why we are selecting genetically modified mice. For this, the best example is the knockout mice. It is genetically engineering mice in which the researchers have inactivated or completely replaced the existing gene with new gene, so that we can understand and we animal by birth itself suffering with particular disorder. Like the best example is hypoglycemic activity. To testing the hypoglycemic activity, we need to induce the hyperglycemia to animal. But if you replace that gene which is responsible for insulin production, by birth itself, animal is deficient with the insulin. And regularly, if you see the animal blood, that is always in hyperglycemia. Then if you administer any drug, if it is reduces blood glucose, no doubt it is an anti-hyperglycemic effect. That is regarding knockout mice. And this causes the changes in mouse by phenotypic and behavior and psychological and biochemical characteristics also. And another important mouse models, animal model which is used commonly is to changing the genetic pattern without disturbing the regular activity. Like behavioral and physiological changes also we can screen by using this knockout mice. This can be also useful for the pathological models for testing the number of drugs effect. Here you can see the nude mice. What is the difference between the first mice and this one is, here these mice are completely free of the hair. That is highly useful for screening the drugs for affecting skin, including the, which may produce as the hair growth, hypertrichosis. That can be useful for the treatment of bald head. Nowadays, you can see the, you commonly observing the people, whoever crossing the 30 plus, the major problem is the hair loss and bald head. That is, previously, we can see with the people who cross the 50 plus, they may frequently affecting by the bald head, but that is not like that. Regularly, and even in teenagers also, they are affected by this bald head. The drugs which are affecting the, are influencing the hair growth, we can test it by these mice. Because if you want to test it, the effect on hair, first initially we need to remove the completely hair from the mice. Later only we should apply our drug. But here the problem is not like that. We can directly apply the product. If the our product can increase the hair, no doubt at all, it will be useful for treatment of bald head and increases the trichosis. That is advantage with this type of mouse. Along with, it can be useful for testing the drugs acting on skin, like TDDS formulations, transdermal drug delivery system, to know the pharmacokinetic profile directly by applying on the skin surface. How can we getting this one is by changing the genetic mutation. The gene is which is responsible for the hair growth, that is replaced by the another gene, so that the animal by birth itself, it is without hair, we can see. That is another advantage with the nude mouse. Now coming to next animal and next rodent, which is commonly preferable for the number of activities is the rat. And the rat average weight, which is preferable for doing activities is 300 to 500 grams. And when compared to the rat and mice, rat having the long life period. And if you want to screen the drug for more than 6 months, then we can choosing the rat as the best animal. As well as the rat can withhold the anesthesia for long time. At that time, we can have an advantage of surgical experiments like isolation of the organ from animal, it including ovarectomy, separation of the ovaries to observe the estrogenic effect and progesterone effect in the rat. And they can easily handle if you treated kindly. That means if you treat kindly, they can handle he easily. Otherwise, they also bite when similar to that of mice. That is another property with the rat. And we can give in the drugs by various routes, including IV and tail mean intravenous, subcutaneous route, intramuscular and intraperitoneal, as well as oral. Next, the drugs can be administered orally by means of tube also. That is another advantage with rat. And as I said previously, these rats are highly preferable for the isolated preparations. Isolated organ preparations can be used by using the rat stomach for anti-ulcer activity, fundus, the same ulcer activity, colon to testing the anti-cancer effect, and the uterus for the estrogenic effect on the female rats. Coming to the handling techniques and how can we handle these rats. If you see the first picture, there we can handle by holding the, within the our forearm. But where in case of second one, that is the right technique to administer any drug. But here the picture is in black color, but the rats are not in black. We should use only the albino rats for our experiments. Don't confuse, black rats are called as a wild rats. We should not use. I just kept for our understanding purpose. It is a albino rats. How we are administering the injection to intraperitoneally. To administer if below the or left quadrant of the abdomen. And another picture, you can clearly observe the administration of the drug through oral route by using oral feeding needles. The feeding needle is something different than the regular whatever we are using for the human being. It is little bit bent that can facilitate easy enter into the oral cavity without any loss of drug in the external. Now coming to next animal, guinea pig. When compared to the rat and mice, these guinea pigs are highly docile and very sensitive animal. It is highly sensitive and easily get respond to the external foreign material and may produce as the rashes and allergy on the skin very fastly. That's why these are highly useful for screening the drugs which may have in the allergic response, which may susceptible to find the, it may having any chances of inducing allergy, then we should always test it on the guinea pigs. If drug doesn't producing any allergic reaction on guinea pig, no doubt at all, it doesn't produce any complication while we administer to the human being, because guinea pigs are highly sensitive rather than the human beings. Next, it doesn't unable to synthesize the vitamin C. That's why while we keeping the diet and while we providing the diet, we should provide the vitamin C along with the diet. That is very important criteria we need to remember. And next one, the isolated muscle preparation of guinea pigs are widely used to test the various activities like bronchospasm and bronchiolytic activity by taking the trachea of guinea pig. And this could be useful for testing the drugs acting on respiratory system as well as drugs acting on immunity, because immune system may stimulating and suppressing the bronchial and bronchoconstriction and spasm also because of the immunoactivation, as well as ileum preparation. Ileum also can be used for testing the number of drugs and their activities. And mode of administration of routes. The drugs can be administered by either intravenous and tail vein, subcutaneous, intramuscular, and intraperitoneally, and directly through oral also, whatever we discussed in previously, like rat, we can administer directly through mouth. And in some cases, we can administer drugs directly through the stomach tube. And what type of activities? What I said previously, histaminic activity and antihistaminic, respiratory and cardiovascular related complications. This guinea pig is the best animal for testing those type of activities. Now coming to the handling technique for guinea pigs, these are highly docile and sensitive. That's why we need to hold it by the two hands, not with the single hand. And we should not create the fear to the animal. If it is highly fear and stressy condition, the animal may die at any time during the study also. We should avoid the death of animal during the study due to stress. That is the most important criteria we need to remember while using the guinea pigs for our studies. Next one, rabbit. I think most of the people may know that regarding rabbit, how it is survive and how it is look like. But while coming to the experiment, we should take care about the rabbit. It should not be eat any other food item other than the what we provided. That is the first thing. And the second thing, while holding the rabbit in the cage, we should take care about the animal should be free from the stress. Because during stress also, the temperature may be elevated. That may disturb the activities. That is the one problem. And the other one is the pyrogens. While we using for the anti test for sterility, we should ensure that the animal is free from the dust environment. And while handling the rabbits, as I said previously, we should hold the arm below the rabbit, and another one is by with the back of the skin. The drugs can be injected intravenously as well as marginal ear beam. And while collecting the drug and blood from the rabbit, we should preferably choose the jugular vein, which is there on the neck region, to continuously collecting the blood for bioassay of insulin. Similarly, it can be also useful for isolated muscle preparations from rabbit for various activities, as well as it can be preferable for the drugs acting on eye, whether it is for treatment of glaucoma or cataract or any other complications. Rabbit is the best animal. Now here, you can see the how the drug injection is administered to the rabbit ear. It is in the second picture. In first picture, we should fold the rabbit entirely without any motility. That is the restraining technique. Rabbit should not move while we administering the drug to the rabbit marginal ear beam. We should take care about during the injection time, it should not be moved at any site. That may lead to the unnecessary injury to the animal. We should avoid that while administration as well as collection of the blood also. Both cases, we should make ensure that animal should not be motile. And this is also the technique how we are handling and before administering the drugs or collecting the blood from the rabbits, how to hold the rabbit. Now, this is regarding animals and how they are acting and how we are using for various activities and what are the applications of the animals in preclinical research. Now, brief regarding the animal house. Just if you see the pictures, how it is look like, and we need to maintain the animal house always as per the regulation of CPCSEA. The committee give the regulations and the guidelines. We should always follow the guidelines according to the CPCSEA. That is most important while we establishing and maintaining the animal house in either establishment or any organization. It may be either academics or industry. And we should ensure that during that period, the day and the night cycle, it should be in equal as like as us. But we are completely deviating from, because if you observe the sleep cycle, it is around 8, remaining all are in daily cycle. But that is not like for rat animals. We should maintain the equal ratio, 12:12, day and light. Second thing is temperature, because the entire activities, what we are doing in the laboratory animal house, they're entirely influenced by the temperature of the environment. Because the temperature will control the metabolism in the animal. The metabolism is clearly influencing the drug response. That's why we should always maintain the wet bulb and dry bulb temperature meter, and regularly we need to monitor the temperature for 3 times per day in animal house, and we should ensure that the temperature as well as relative humidity both are in the same from total day, and we need to maintain the books also and record to keep the temperature as well as humidity. That is very important criteria for maintenance of laboratory house. And last one is providing of water and food. Water should be the ad libitum, and a diet that should be contain the highly nutritious diet, because the entire drug response is depend on the food which is provided to the animal also. Not only temperature, food also plays a major role. How it the food influencing the drug response is the simple concept. That is, we all are very well known about the protein binding of the drug. If any drug having the protein binding capacity, we should know whenever drug animal receiving the protein diet, then only the plasma half life may be obtained equally to that of the protein binding. If the animal receiving without protein, we can get the plasma half life very rapidly and Cmax in early. But where in case of if the same drug is administered to the human being, it may bind to the protein, may lead to the wrong results. To avoid that, we should provide the highly nutritious diet to the animal throughout the study and the post study also. Not only the study, post study also we should provide the highly nutritious diet to get the accurate result, which may similar to that of the human being. Then only our trial will be approved. Next one is the adaptation period. I think currently from last 2020 onwards, I think everybody may know about the quarantine. Previous that, may some of the people may not know regarding the quarantine. That is nothing but whenever if you purchasing the animal from outside, we should not mix that animal with our animal house. We should keep the animal in separately in quarantine to adapt it to the our environment, new environment. After that only we should mix with our animal and proceed with our projects or activities. That is regarding the few points you need to remember while using the animals for the researches. These are the just few images related to animals whenever if you place it in the cages. While placing the animal in cages, we should take care about the labeling. That is also one important thing, because the label should be present outside of the animal cage. That should not be in inside. If you keep it in inside, at any time animal may eat the label. That may lead to unnecessary disturbances to our trial. That's why if you observe the all cages, the label will be clearly visible and observed, and what type of activity is going on and what is the species name and sex, everything we should enter on the label. That is the most important thing. And if you observe the picture, you can clearly see the bedding material, which is frequently used for the animal, as well as it having the two lid containing the two chambers. One is the food chamber and another one is the wash bottle chamber. We need to provide regularly water as well as food to the animal. And if you observe the number of animal also, that should be in a limit. It should not be more than the 3 in single cage to prevent the stress and unnecessary danger, unnecessary complication to the animal. With this, I conclude the my session. Thank you one and all for patient listening. If you have any doubts, you can ask.
Session completed, madam.
Yeah, it's over.
Dear participants, any questions? Please chat the box.
You can ask orally also, no problem. I will answer. students, whoever having any doubts, have you understood or not? If you have any doubts and queries, you can ask, no problem. Students, is it audible or not? If you have any doubts,
ma'am, ma'am, question adigara, ma'am, why zebra fish is more preferred? Question adigara, ma'am, someone.
What, sir? Zebra fish is more preferred.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that is the question.
Yeah, that one is question, ma'am. Ma'am, why zebra fish?
Sir, here
is
it
more...
is not visible for question. Can you?
Why zebra fish is more preferred? ఎందుకు జీబ్రా ఫిష్ ని ప్రిఫర్ చేస్తున్నారు అని అడుగుతున్నారు మేడం క్వశ్చన్. హలో,
వెయిట్ మినిట్ సార్, ఇట్ ఈస్ దిస్, సారీ ఫర్ ఇన్కన్వీనియన్స్. బికాస్ ద నర్వస్ టిష్యూ విచ్ ఈస్ దేర్ ఇన్ ద జీబ్రా ఫిష్ అండ్ వీ కెన్ ఈజీలీ ఐసోలేట్ ద జీబ్రా ఫిష్ బ్రెయిన్ అండ్ ద న్యూరాన్స్ అండ్ న్యూరో ట్రాన్స్మిటర్స్ విచ్ ఈస్ సెక్రెటెడ్ ఇన్ ద బ్రెయిన్ ఈస్ వెరీ సిమిలర్ అండ్ ఫెమిలియర్ టు దట్ ఆఫ్ హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్. And if you want to test it related to the neurological activities, the brain is very essential and we need to isolate the brain. That will be easiest one and which give the accurate, not accurate, we can get the maximum similar results that we can expected in the human beings also, predicted results. That's why zebra fishes are